scraping the bottom of the barrel right now. My name's Adam. I'm glad you're here. I'm the youth director. Well, Phil already prayed for us, so I'm just going to go ahead and mention, if you're a visitor here, we have the connection cards in front of you. If you don't mind filling that out, if you're new to South Park, you can take that to the table in front of you and get a gift for joining us. Also on the back, if you have a prayer request, you want to get to the church office, you can put that in the offering plate, and it will get to the appropriate place. A couple of quick announcements. Don't forget, Saturday is Melissa's heart anniversary from 2 to 4 p.m. in the fellowship hall. Everyone is invited to come. Tonight we have a call to business meeting, so please make plans to be here for that. The women's group invites you to dinner at Mexico Real Thursday at 6:30, so please RSVP with Joe Strong.
Or Sue.
Or Sue.
Right after
church. Second?
Right after church.
Right after church tonight. Next Sunday morning.
Today, this morning,
he
has.
What's that, 6:30?
Oh, no.
RSVP
as soon as possible.
Tell us as soon as possible. For more information, please see Joe. All right. Next Sunday morning, we will have a brief call business meeting following the morning service. Very brief, since everybody's here. Just one quick item of business. Check out your other items, other stuff having a South Park in your bulletin, and then Ms. Laura is going to come talk to you real quick about yes.
Woo!
Somebody's excited about PBS.
We have several things planned to get ready for that. We're going to get those listed and hung out, but I'll go ahead and let you know real quick. June the 15th, we're going to meet at 9 a.m. to make our decorations. We're working on what we are going to make them out of, if we're just going to kind of paint them on paper, if we can find some of the things like we used last year that was thicker and a little more adorable. June 29th, we're going to go and knock on doors and let the neighborhood and everybody know that we're having Bible school. We really would love a good turnout this year. We didn't have such a great turnout last year, so really, really, really would love if everybody could come help us with that. And then July 6th, this Sunday, I mean the Saturday, of course, before it starts, we'll be here to decorate. And we're going to meet about 9 a.m. for that. While we're thinking about this and getting it in our heads, if anybody has like any kind of Western wear or anything, you know, decor, like, I have a saddle I brought for my mom's and that kind of thing. So if you have any of that kind of thing, just let us know or bring it up there on Saturday when we start to decorate. We also need a female adult that would be willing to be in the skit if someone wants to do that. Brother Mark is going to be our silly man because that only makes sense. But if there's any females that would like to do that, just let us know. I do have our teacher's books, so please sign up to be a teacher. We still have some links. And I'll get those books to you as soon as you're ready. And then lastly, please just sign up for something. We have some links up there, and we'd appreciate it if you would just join us. And we've about decided if your name is not on there, we're going to sign you up. So, you know, there is some blank down there. If you really don't want it, you better say not me, because I'm not putting you on.
All right, wait. Why are you still standing? Don't have a seat. Sorry. We do want to make you aware that we have a black screen back here, and we got kind of used to that. See the lyrics up here and so forth. But we're working on this projection. We go to the park court, and we're trying to get it fixed. So bear with us as we. And so we'll just keep printing the words, put the bulletin, and until we get it fixed. Hopefully in the next week or two we'll have that up and running again, so bear with us. All right. We are doing hymn number 494, follow on. Let's sing together, follow on.
Thank you.
and amen.
All right, as we're getting ready to worship the Lord by giving, I miss Brother David. That's the word I learned from him. He did a pretty good job singing that, isn't it? This is a part of a worship.
Amen.
We worship together when we give.
Amen.
And as we get ready to take our offering, lately we have lost some of our good members in the church, and their place is empty here, yet there is a new chair set up in heaven for them. So would you please be in a prayer for the families, for the O'Haron family, for the Ray family, for the Yarbrough family, and others who have lost a loved one, because there's still empty place in the heart of those who are still behind. So please pray for them continuously, if you will. By the way, this is wonderful to see this man. I keep finding new talents in Brother Adam. Praise the Lord. Isn't that great? All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Charles, would you please lead us?
Says, I charge you in the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears. They will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. For I am ready, already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Take these words from your head, from your heart, to your hands, and live them out every day of your life. You may be seated.
Thank you. but I want you to hear this, because it's just so lovely. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. The great high priest whose name is love, who ever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands. My name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no time can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me from above and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and I see him there who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, by perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. I was going to say, all right, we heard the preaching, let's go. Amen. That's great. I love my wife singing. I enjoy it very much. All right, glad you're here today. Good to see all of your happy faces. We do have a couple of visitors, Brother Cleveland. We're going to meet soon, hopefully again. And my sister, I'm sorry, I can't remember your name. We met one time a little while ago. You are a friend of Brother David, I know. And I'm glad you're back. It's so good to see you. And everybody else, glad to see each and every one here. If you still have your Bibles open to the book of 2 Timothy chapter 4, if not, turn there, please. That's our passage. Gonna look at the view from the end zone. While you're getting there, y'all have heard that St. Peter is the one that welcomes people into heaven, right? I've heard that many times. Well, St. Peter was standing by the pearly gates welcoming the new people in. All of a sudden, he saw a lot of bankers from Wall Street, all of the high executives coming in. He'd never seen that many bank executives, top people, walk into the pearly gate before. So he runs to God and says, what am I supposed to do? God says, this is heaven. Treat him as everybody else. Go welcome him in. Okay, so he returns to the pearly gates. A few minutes later, he comes back shaking his head. He said, they're gone. He said, who? The bankers? Said, no, the pearly gates. I'm not insinuating anything. You know, whenever I watch football games, I always stay tuned and watch the after-game interviews. Now, you see, most of the times, the interviewees, the players, the coaches, they are very specific about the reasons they won or they lost, because calling the game is a whole lot easier after you played the game. You know, you look back, you can tell what you did right and the things that went wrong. It's always easier to call the game from end zone. By the way, life is a lot like that too. You know, it's easier to look back. It's kind of hard. It's actually impossible to look ahead and see what is going to happen. We will all come to win in a game of life. But then there are times when we must walk away having lost the big game. Now, as I read these verses that Brother Adam read to us this morning, I'm aware that Paul is standing in the end zone of his life, and he's looking back at the good game that he has played, a good race he has run. So these verses are, if you will, as close as we get to an after-game interview with Paul. At this point, for all the intents and the purposes, Paul's ministry is over. He is sitting in a Roman prison with nothing to look forward to but an execution in the hands of a Roman government. Paul knows his time is up, but you know, before he leaves for glory, he wants to give us one last after-game interview. And my friend, I'm glad he did. You see, here's a man who played a good game, who ran a good race. He didn't fumble the ball. He hardly got tackled. He stumbled once or twice, but he reached the end zone of his life with his testimony and his ministry still intact. Thank God for a man like that. I think he might have something to say that we might be interested in, don't you? That's why I would like for us to listen in to these words that Paul talks to us, these great words of Apostle Paul. He, in effect, writes his own epitaph. Y'all know what an epitaph is, right? This is what your loved ones, hopefully your loved ones, not your enemies, have engraved in your tombstones, right? Now, when I think of an epitaph, there's a couple I remember seeing. One of them said, "Here lies Lester Hayes, first Lux from Lester Moore, sorry. Here lies Lester Moore, four slugs from a 44. No less, no more." Get that? Lester, no less, more, no more. Anyway. Then there was these couple of headstones I saw in a very old cemetery next to a Methodist church. And on a few of these headstones, there was an index finger pointing towards heaven. I assume telling us that that's what they thought the deceased have gone to be in heaven. But then there was a few that had two hands chained together at the wrist with the hand pointing toward hell. What a terrible testimony. Now, I think if Paul would have supervised the chiseling of his own epitaph, he would have put down the words of verse 7. "I fought a good fight. I finished my race. I kept the faith." You know, this great man wrote his own epitaph before his death. In these words of these verses, we find this after-game interview of a faithful servant of Christ. What Paul does here is he breaks down the whole Christian life into three neat and a clear components. What he has to say to us about his walk with the Lord Jesus Christ will help each and every one of us in our own walk as we too inch ever closer to the end zone of our own life. So would you notice with me what is important, what was important to Paul as he stood in the end zone of his life? First of all, Paul speaks of the warfare. Paul speaks of a warfare. In verse 7, both words, fight and fought, translating the word agon. Now, this word gives us the very English word agony. Y'all are familiar with that, right? There was in Paul's time, this word was used to describe the Greek games, ancient Greek games, if you will. Now, it was times when the Greek people would do these games and struggle against each other for supremacy. Now, the context that Paul is talking about in this warfare, I believe, happened to be the wrestling that was very popular in Paul's time. You know, what Paul is trying to get through to us is that believers are not in the playground. We are in the battlefield, my friend. You see, in our Christian walk, we engage in a battle, a spiritual battle. And the best word that sometimes describes that battle is the word agony. Now, let us see what Paul has to say about this battle, about this agony he faced. First of all, the entry into this warfare. You see, you and I enter that warfare whenever we are born again. As soon as a person is saved by grace, he becomes a new creation. That's what 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us. We become a new spiritual creature. Now, before conversion, I hope you've been here while we were going through the book of Ephesians. In the book of Ephesians chapter 2, you'll see that before conversion, we were all dead in trespasses and sin. We were all dead to the things of God. We were all willing to participate in the works and activities of the devil. However, when we are converted, we become alive in God, in the works of God. The Holy Spirit comes and lives in us. But the problem that lies with this is the fact that the old nature, that sinful old nature, is still alive. And you know, this creates this tremendous conflict, because in the believer, the new man wants to please God while the old man wants to live for the flesh, live for the world. And you add to this Satan, who tries to block you, to make you fall, make you stumble in your walk, and you have a great recipe of a conflict and a battle. Now, I think you would agree with me when I say that this life, this Christian life you and I live, is filled with spiritual battles, especially if you try to live for the Lord, especially if you try to please God. Now, also, he tells us that the enemy in that warfare, my friend, I would like you to understand this. Another human being is never the enemy. He may be used by the Satan for his purpose, but no man is the enemy. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, make it clear. Listen to this. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Therefore, we need to learn to forgive each other. We need to learn to walk in love as God has asked us to do. My friend, he said, be kind, forgiving to each other. You know, most of the times we're so guilty of fighting among each other because of stupid things. And when you do that, I shouldn't have said stupid, right? That's a word, you know, you should, no word. But you know, this is an attitude that God never, ever blesses. We cannot fight among each other. First thing we need to know is to understand who enemy is. His name is Satan. And he comes to you dressed as the angel of light. No wonder he is so successful. He comes covering and hiding his true colors. He makes us start fighting the wrong enemy among ourselves. A person may be a tool in the hands of a devil. A person may speak the devil's words. The person might start doing the business of a devil in a church or towards you, but that person is never the enemy. If anything, that type of person needs our prayer more than anything else. Then thirdly, there is the energy of this warfare. The energy. You see, when Paul says, I have fought a good fight, he's not talking about taking that credit for himself, for having a successful ministry. It's not him. He is echoing the same thing he said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I'll read it. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Now Paul may be the one in the battlefront. Paul may be the one in the trenches, but his energy comes from the one that lives within him. Thank God we don't have to fight those spiritual battles alone. Thank God I don't have to do it in my own power. We can fight those battles if we just learn to stand in the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, if we ever learn to tap into Christ's power, we will be able to come to the end of our end zone and stand and say confidently, I have fought a good fight. Finally, the equipment in this warfare. Now, let me remind you again, you're not fighting a battle with fleshly nature. You see, neither our weapons are fleshly in nature. Actually, in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, starting at verse 3, this is what Paul wrote. For though we walk in the flesh, we don't war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God in the pulling down our strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. My friend, carnal people use carnal weapons. Weapons like the stinging arrow of gossip, the cruel spear of personal attack, the sharp sword of threatening word, the harsh whip of cowardice and deception. These are weapons of evil. But you know what? Spiritual weapons of our warfare are designed just to enable us to stand. To stand and let our God fight the battles for us. By the way, the list of those weapons you find in the book of Ephesians chapter 6. They are belt of truth, breastplate of righteousness, boots of gospel, buckler of faith, bonnet of salvation, blade of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and a Spirit-filled prayer. Now, my friend, in fact, all of the weapons I just called, these are defensive in nature, except for, of course, the Word of God and the prayer. Now, each and every one of these need to be used for God's glory and properly. Have you ever heard of blinding laser weapons? Anybody here? Yeah, y'all are not in the warfare much, huh? Us guys, that's all we do, right? Now, what these blinding laser weapons are these weapons that are designed to blind the soldiers of the enemy. Now, of course, they've gone beyond that. You see, most of the countries kind of stick to the international law to limit their weapons power, but not Chinese. As a matter of fact, Chinese, not too long ago, came up with one that was called what, ZM-87, portable laser guns. These, their effect was to make an enemy blind. Now, honestly, you don't really have to be a very knowledgeable of the warfare or know a lot about tactics of war to understand that you really don't have to kill your enemy to stop them from fighting. All you got to do is make them blind, right? And they are useless. Well, guess what? Satan doesn't have to destroy each and every one of us to take us out of the game. All he has to do is to blind us to the truth of the Word of God. We already know that he does it to the unbelievers, right? Listen to this. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. The God of this world has blinded the mind of them which believe not. So, okay, that is what he does to the non-believers. How about us, the soldiers of the cross? My friend, nothing's changed. He does the same. He bombards our minds with those lies of the world, with those desires of the flesh. And guess what? Unless a child of God pick up those weapons that I just talked about and stand firm and pray, each and every one of us will be blinded and out of the game. May God help us to watch our mind, protect our mind from all of those garbage that the world is lasering into our minds. Let's protect ourselves. All right, so after the warfare, Paul speaks about the walk. Now, Paul turns from the wrestling arena to the track and field area. All right, now here, his mind is talking about the runners in the Greek, ancient Greek games. These runners used to run long distances to receive their reward. Now, Paul gives us some insight into this race. First of all, he mentions a race. Look at this word, course. The word course literally means career. It means a race. You know, Paul just reminding us that each and every one of us have a race to run. That's what your life as a Christian is. You have a race to run. Now, this thought is echoed in Hebrews chapter 12, especially verses 1, 2, and 3. Now, there is a few things that I want to pass on to you about this race that you and I are engaged in. And you say, what are you talking about, race? You can't even run a foot, right? But this is the race Paul is talking about. And this race is individual in nature. This is an individual race. What am I talking about? We're not competing against each other. You and I are not running against each other. Now, you gotta remember this one very good. Why? Because if we forget about it, then jealousy starts setting in. We start running somebody else's race. Why is their race much easier? They're running in the shade, I'm running in the sun. And once the jealousy comes, it causes us to stumble. Secondly, I can't run your race, you can't run my race. You see, our individual courses are planned for us by the righteous judge, by God himself. God decides the degree of a difficulty of your race. Don't be looking at somebody else's race. Look at your own. He decides where we run and how long we run. By the way, the best thing is to stay in the lane that God put you. Run your own race. After all, I have enough to answer for my own race than looking at your race and answer for yours. Right? I can't run your race. Thirdly, there is only one person to watch in this race. You know, when you're running this race of life, you can't be looking at your neighbor. You can't look at somebody else running this race. You gotta keep your eyes focused on the Lord Jesus Christ, because he is the only one that matters in the race of life. And finally, whether your race is short or you're long, you can finish well. That's a promise. Listen, Lord will not judge us based on how somebody else run their race. All we gotta do, gotta run our own, and my race stands on itself. Well, that was all about the race. Y'all are excited, right? Secondly, he mentions a reality. Listen to this. When Paul uses the word finish, you can almost hear him say, what a race. It's a long one. You know, Paul is actually referring to the ancient game of marathon. Now, if you didn't know about marathon, well, about 490 BC, the Greek historians write that there was a crucial battle between the forces of Athens against a king of Persia, King Darius the First, and they think that they won the battle. Well, okay, let's give it to them. Us Iranians think different. But anyway, that's not the important. But when the battle is over, one soldier, all the way from the battlefield, which is in the coast of Greece, in a little town named Marathon, he runs all the way back to Athens to take the word of winning or defeat. Doesn't matter. By the time he gets there, his unreserved effort ends with him falling dead in the arms of the people he delivered the message to. Well, today, that grace is all about attributing the tribute to the soldier. And it's called about the battlefield, of course. You see, that soldier completed his race, and there is no nobler way to die for a man than finishing his race. You know what Paul is telling us? He says he finished his course. Because if you look at verse 10, you'll see there was others, like Demas, that did not finish his race. My friend, the reality of the matter is this. The race of world, the race of life is difficult. Some of us will not finish. We fall by the wayside. We stop running. That's just the reality. That's why when you read Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, it tells you that you need to put off all of the extra weight when you start running the race. It's talking about our sins. But you know, obviously, as I said, not everyone in this room will finish well. But you know, you can. That's the next reality. You can finish well if you keep your eyes on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you run your race for the Lord Jesus and just to please him and him alone, no one else. Finally, he mentions a reward. Now, look here. The competitors in ancient Greece, they competed for these crowns made out of leaves. Either oak leaves or laurel leaves. You've heard about resting on your laurels. That's what it's talking about. Banking on your crowns anyway. By the way, these trophies, probably a month after they stunk, you had to throw them away, right? These days, our runners get trophies, they get medals. They will tarnish. They have to be thrown away or put away somewhere. But Paul is looking beyond the end zone of his life. He's looking at the Lord Jesus Christ standing at the end of the race, and he will give a reward to everyone who finishes well. Paul is telling us that we need to keep racing. Don't be looking for other people to reward you or cheer you on. You're not racing for others. The Lord is watching your race. He is the one that is watching everything you do, and he will reward what you do. Notice he calls the Lord righteous judge. The righteous judge sees it all. Mankind may not understand your race, but he does. And he will reward you if you keep on running. Don't stop. Grandma Cha Saw Soon. Now, y'all think this is a lie, but it's not. It really is. Y'all Google this about the lady that was taking the written part, not now though, okay, later on, written part of a test in South Korea. And you'll see that this story is real. Back in September of 2010, a lady, Grandma Cha Saw Soon, who lived in South Korea, about 112 miles south of Seoul, Korea, wanted to have a driver's license. She was about 69 years old. Well, she goes to get her driver's license, but she does not succeed in the first try. As a matter of fact, not once, not twice, not three times, not 10 times, not 20 times, 959 times. This is real, folks. 959 times she fails the written part of a test. Now, of course, she only failed four times for the actual driving part, but she finally received that. Now, I guess she was just didn't know the terminology, and it took her that many times to do it. But you know what? By this time, the whole Korea knew about her. And she became a national hero. They even gave her a Kia Soul. You know, one of those ones that the rats drive around. Well, she became a national hero of Korea because she passed the written test. And then, of course, the driving 960 times. You know what was important in here? She didn't give up. She didn't stop. 69-year-old lady keep doing it till she won. My friend, how many people you know, except for Grandma Cha Sa-soon, that becomes a hero of a nation just because passing a written test of a driver? How many you know that beside this grandma that has ever become a national hero? Not many, have we? But you know what? The more difficult the game is, the sweeter it is when you prevail. All I'm trying to say in here is, don't quit. This is a very important race you and I are living. This is living the life for Christ Jesus. It's not just driving, right? It's running. All right, so Paul speaks of warfare. Paul speaks of his walk. Finally, this is a sweet word to everybody when a preacher says finally, right? He speaks about the word. Paul ends his epitaph by calling people's attention to how he handles the word of God. Now listen, since Paul was a preacher, many people think, well, I don't have to listen to this. This is just have to do with the preachers. Well, got to tell you, the truth is that this, not just for the preachers, there is a word here for each and every person who hears it. First of all, he has preserved the message. You see what he says? I have kept the faith. You know, this means that he guarded it. He watched it. He took care of it just like it was a precious jewel, which it is. The Word of God is a precious treasure. So how did Paul protect the faith? Well, he maintained it in its purest form. He not only maintained it, but he also gave it away to those who would do the same thing he did. Listen. This is 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who will be able to learn to teach others also. You need to pass it on. You know, there are a lot of opinions about how we should run a church, what the church's job is. But my friend, we need to be a storehouse of God's Word. We need to be like a Fort Knox for the God's Word. We need to protect it. We need to refuse to let it alter a bit. We need to faithfully pass it on to the next generation. That's our job. In fact, one of the surest ways to gauge the effectiveness of a church is to look what they do with the Word of God. You see, if they are keeping it safe, they don't let it change, they are sticking by the Word of God. They are heroes of faith. They've done good. But if they let it slip, if they change the message, they are in error. Secondly, he proclaimed the Master. My friend, the most important part involved in this idea of keeping the faith is sharing it. You can't just put it on their lock and key. Anybody knows what a hope diamond is? It's a very important jewel, isn't it? You go to a museum to see hope diamond, it's placed beyond a foot of glass. You can see, you can't touch. That's how it goes in a museum. You go to watch Monet, it's beautiful on the wall, but you cannot touch. My friend, that is different when it comes to gospel. Our gospel is the only treasure that it becomes more valuable when you share it. It becomes more valuable when you give it away. It becomes more valuable when other people know about it. Paul is telling us that while we're guarding this gospel, we also must be giving it away. So I encourage you, give this treasure away. Don't keep it under lock and key. Whenever we become that way to give it to ourselves, we start becoming like those dirty, old, dusty museums. You know, when people come and just see the gospel, hear the gospel preached in the church, but don't touch. We'll just tell you what you need to know. However, when it becomes active in giving away of that, it brings new life. It brings new purpose to the church, and not only to that, to your lives. Give it away. Read your Bible and share it. And thirdly, he had protected the messenger. You see what he says? I have kept the faith. Here is a man who's reached the end of his world, the end of his journey, and he's still clutching to the word of God. Not only with his hands, but also with his heart. You know, through all of the battles, through all of those lonely journeys in the valleys of life, he never fell out of love with Jesus. Despite the fact that he was lonely, he was discouraged, he was beaten up, he stayed to the things of God. You know what is he saying in here? He says, you're going to have a rough time in your Christian life. It's not going to be always easy. People will not understand you. People misunderstand you. People mistreat you. People will do you wrong. But my friend, you need to stick with the word of God. Listen, there will be days when you have to walk alone. Nobody wants to walk with you. But in spite of what they may tell you to go through, what the world puts you through, all of the troubles, keep your faith in Jesus Christ. Now, if you can, keep your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ and you run your race. When you race, when you get to the end of the race, you can always look back and say, I have kept the faith. My friend, not everybody is going to be able to say that. But those who keep their faith in Jesus and Jesus alone can. Listen, I assure you that the Lord Jesus Christ will not fail you. You ask David, his best friends failed him. But if you stick with Jesus, when you run to the end of the end zone, you'll notice that you still are in the possession of the ball. Your life meant something. Just keep running and stick close to Jesus. When you get to the end, you can say, I have kept the faith. Don't you want to be able to say that when you get to the end? I do. My friend, what kind of epitaph would people put on your headstone? Regardless of what people say about us, regardless of what friends or enemies tell about us, the only one that matters is the Lord Jesus Christ. You're running the race for him. Keep running it. Don't give up. Well, you might be here and you have stumbled in your walk with God. Maybe you have just kept your eyes off of the race and you walked away a little bit. Maybe you're stumbling with giving the word of God away. Maybe you're shy. Maybe you don't know what or how. Guess what? That's what we need to go to Jesus and ask. If you're a child of God, you have the Holy Spirit of God living within you. That's the best teacher. That's the one that wrote this book, by the way. You come to him. You ask him, and he will show you. If you have gone away from the Lord, that's what the invitation time is. We need to get on our knees, confess our sins. My friend, that's what confession means, agreeing with God. Agreeing that what I'm doing is wrong and doing it His way, not my way anymore. Back then, altars, they would take animals and sacrifice by the altar. Now, we don't need to sacrifice any animal because Jesus died and His precious blood paid for our sins. Now we come to the altar, sacrifice our ego. We think, I cannot confess sins. People might know I've sinned this week. Man, my friend, everybody sins. If you say you are not a sinner, you lie. That's what we just learned in a Sunday school. But we sacrifice that ego. We throw our ego down and we agree with God. I'm sorry I did it. Help me not to do it again. Get me up and help me keep going. Let me run a good race so at the end I can look back and say, I have fought a good fight. I have kept the faith. My friend, you may be just here, but you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. If that's so and you feel the need in your heart, that's the Holy Spirit of God talking to you. I will be down here. If you don't want to come in front of people, come and get a hold of me. We'll talk about this. You need to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. You don't know when your time's going to run out. If your need is church membership, well, we are a friendly congregation looking for good members, right? So you come forward. Whatever your need is, whatever the Lord Jesus Christ has put on your hearts, don't quench the Spirit. It's time to answer. Now, would you stand with me, please, with your heads bowed and eyes closed as the musicians come? We will pray and we'll have a time of invitation. It's not my invitation. It's not this church's invitation. It's the Lord Jesus Christ's invitation. What are we singing, man?
I have decided.
I have decided.